A lot of you have already brought them in, so thank you very much for all of your generosity and all the ways that you contributed. And if you by chance have one, if you can drop it off tomorrow, that would be great. And if there's an issue, just email Vicki, Vicki Ernst, and she will know exactly what it is because she checks them off. So we appreciate her work with that. She's actually having a Christmas party for the first and second graders, I think. I want to thank the Andersons for hosting the Christmas party last night. Thanks for everybody coming out. We had a lot of fun, a lot of good food. I know it was a rainy night, but it was good to get together. So we have a lot of Christmas activities coming up, Advent Christmas activities this week. So on Wednesday, there will be a no-rehearsal Christmas play, Christmas pageant, along with meatballs and spaghetti. And what time does the service, I mean, the food start?
6 for those who are not packed, 5:30 for those who are out.
Okay, so if you bring your children, if you bring them at 5:30, that'll help. And if you're coming just to eat and watch, 6 o'clock is fine, and we'll meet down in the CFC. And if you'd like to stay till 7, we'll have golden evening prayer, which is a beautiful contemplative prayer service at 7, and then choir at 7:30. So that's all on Wednesday, and then Sunday, you want to tell us what's going on Sunday?
Sunday first, if you have committed to making breakfast casseroles for our brunch in Bethlehem, I have plenty of turkeys here, so I'm going to put them out there so folks can grab them on the way out. Brunch in Bethlehem will take place after service. We have food, our pancake pros have signed up, or the commets, I can mention. Because they're going to be our pancake pros. There's going to be a cookie exchange, there's crafts and games, and lots of photo-taking opportunities, so it's an event you don't want to miss. If you haven't done so already on your communication card, please sign up so that we can make sure we have enough food. There is one opportunity still to volunteer if you're looking to help. We can use someone to make all of the coffee on Sunday morning, because, of course, you know Lutherans, they love their coffee. So you have to make sure we have plenty of it. And afterwards, if you'd like to stick around and help clean up, that helps too. And I know Priscilla has an announcement. It's about Angel Tree?
Yeah, we said that tomorrow is the deadline.
All right, and the only other announcement is, you know, Christmas Eve, a lot of you travel, so we really don't assign people to be the assistant minister or the ushers or the greeters or the acolyte or Christopher on Christmas Eve because we don't know who's going to be in town. So if your plans have taken shape and you know which of the three services you're going to attend, 5, 7, 11, and you can assist, there's sign-up sheets on the back wall. And just put down what you can do, and whatever you can do will be helpful. But it does take quite a few people to have three worship services, so we appreciate all your help with that. I think that's all the announcements, and we have a special prelude today from the Bell Choir. Thank you. confession of forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the parent who rouses us from slumber, the shepherd who gathers us on the holy mountain, the deliverer who sets us free.
Amen.
Let us come before the living God in confession as we wait, as we watch for the promised day of salvation. We open our hearts to you, O God. Search us and know us. Reveal all that we keep inside. To you, O God, we confess our sins, known and unknown. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us in your ways of justice and peace. Make us reflections of the radiant love of your Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Beloved children of the Most High, you are gathered before the righteous judge, who has mercy on all. Splash exuberantly in the waters of your baptism, where sin is washed away in the river of life. Dwell peacefully in the loving arms of the one who nurtures all creation. Go forth boldly in the assurance that your sins are forgiven. In the name of the one who is coming and is already here, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Please remain standing for our opening hymn. Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Stir up the wills of all who look to you, Lord God, and strengthen our faith in your coming, that transformed by grace, we may walk in your way. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we light the Advent wreath and sing Light One Candle, Watch One Sun.
Shadows of sadness, families who have lost loved ones, people in prison, people who were isolated and feel on their own. When I look around,
I see shadows of grief, people dreading the holidays
because of painful memories,
or because they don't want to spend another Christmas alone.
In the face of sadness, we light a candle of joy. May the light of this candle overwhelm the world.
May the light of this candle save all that God's glory is coming, on earth as it already is in heaven.
Friends, be not afraid. God's joy is at hand.
They're cleaning a bench. Does that sound very fun to clean a bench? If it sounds like you want a clean event, you can come to my house. But they had joy in their hearts. It's hard work to clean a bench. They were getting some graffiti off. You helped at that part? We picked up lots. Yeah, I know. But we had joy when we did that. We were helping somebody else, right? What's happening in this picture? Can you tell? They're rebuilding a house. They're working on the roof. So this is some of our youth from SOS, which we will be headed to in this upcoming year, where we help homeowners that have houses that haven't been able to be taken care of. And they're working hard in the hot, hot sun. It's summertime. They're on top of a roof, and it's over 100 degrees in Memphis. So it doesn't sound too fun, but they had joy when they were doing that because they knew that it was not about them. It was about the home. And then here's one more picture. I think this is one of my favorite pictures of jumping for joy. This is Max again when he was about 4. That was the first time he ever saw the ocean. Oh. You see that? He's literally jumping for joy. That's where we were. We were in Florida too. So what I want you to remember about joy is that joy has many faces. Sometimes we might have tears in our eyes, but we still have joy in our hearts. Sometimes we're working hard out in the hot sun or it might be super cold, but we can still have joy in our hearts because we may be doing something for somebody else. And sometimes we are so happy that we're literally jumping for joy. So I want you guys to think about what are the faces of joy that you see in the week ahead. Okay? Thanks for coming. God bless you.
Our first reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 35. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are of fearful heart, be strong, do not fear. Here is your God. He will come with vengeance, with terrible recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For waters shall break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The haunt of jackals shall become a swamp. The grass shall become reeds and rushes. A highway shall be there, and it shall be called the Holy Way. The unclean shall not travel on it, but it shall be for God's people. No traveler, not even fool, shall go astray. No lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast come up on it. They shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransom of the Lord shall return, and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading comes from James chapter 5. Be patient, therefore, beloved, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious crop from the earth, being patient with it until it receives the early and the late rains. You also must be patient. Strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. Beloved, do not grumble against one another, so that you may not be judged. See, the judge is standing at the doors. As an example of suffering and patience, beloved, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 11th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
When John heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another?" Jesus answered, "Go tell John what you hear and see by the wind." What then did he go out to see? Someone dressed in soft robes? Look, those who wear soft robes are in royal places. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, more than a prophet, this is the one to whom it is written, see, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you. Truly I tell you, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist. Yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. And as we can continue along in this Advent season, that's hard to believe, we're already lit the third candle, the candle of joy, which means the 4 weeks of Advent are going by really fast, and Christmas Eve will be here soon. But today's gospel lesson is not one of the traditional Advent, it's an Advent reading, but it's not a Christmassy reading. It's not one that we think of as a Christmas lesson, because today's setting, I don't know if you caught it, but the setting, John is in jail. John the Baptist has been arrested. And John's confused about the whole turn of events. And John now has some doubts. And John is asking, is Jesus really the Messiah? Is Jesus the one that he thought he was? Or, as he says, are we to wait for another one? When I was pastoring my first church in Atlanta, Georgia, occasionally one of our church members would end up in the DeKalb County Jail, which is a big structure right on I-285. And for me, going to visit someone in the jail was always a bit intimidating. You know, you got to think, I got to make sure I got all my identification correctly. And you have to have two forms of identification. And one of them, because a pastor can go visit basically any time, has to prove that you're a pastor, that you're not just scamming them to get into the jail, right? So the city gives us these official ELCA clergy card. So I have to make sure I have that and get there. Of course, you got to go through the metal detectors. You got to be searched. You got to empty your pockets. You got to be patted down. And then this jail is a big one. You got to go through all these long hallways up an industrial elevator because it's about an 8-foot jail. And you finally, every door you go to, you got to look at the camera, tell them who you are. And then they buzz the door and they let you through. And eventually you make it to the, quote, visitor area, which isn't much of a visited area. It's just a concrete area with a big plexiglass separation. And you sit on one side, and the incarcerated person sits on the other side in their orange jumpsuit, and you both pick up telephones to talk to one another. So it's a very, you know, humbling experience for everybody. It's not where anybody wants to be. And it's been humiliating for all involved. And this is the setting where John is, but John's prison would have been much worse. It would have been a dungeon of some sort. And first century prisons, basically the Romans, or in this case Herod, they lock you up and they don't feed you. You rely on family and friends to bring you food. That wasn't their job to feed you. If you starve, they could care less. And so John the Baptist is in a really bad way. And so he sends a messenger to Jesus. So John the Baptist had some disciples too, and sent one of his disciples to talk to Jesus' disciples and say, are you the one? Are you the one that we're waiting for? And it's interesting because there's some confusion here. And we don't think of that. You know, we don't think of John having confusion. That maybe it shows us that John is human like we are, that John has some confusion. And so John is in prison, and he wants to know what the Messiah is doing, so he sends the word with his disciples and says, are you the one to come, or are we waiting for another? And so John has questions and doubt. He's no longer 100% sure that things are going to his plan the way he saw it. And maybe John didn't think he would end up in prison at all. And certainly it's not the place he wanted to be. Or maybe he thought that Jesus would cause a rebellion and come get him out. And so John doesn't know what to think. And he begins to doubt. And maybe he's a little bit like us when we have our times of doubt. And so one way to think about this text is, how do we deal with doubt? And how do we deal with troubles? If John can go from confidence to skepticism, then he's not alone, and we're not alone in that. John is not too different from us. as John goes from confidence to uncertainty, from anticipation to disappointment, as John goes from hope that the Messiah is here to desperation, what's going to happen in this jail? And this is not too unfamiliar for us, for we regularly charge ahead with our dreams and our plans, only to come up short. Whether we're struck by illness or cancer, or we lose a job, or unexpectedly transferred, or we experience the death of a loved one, the loss of a relationship, or by one of a thousand other things that can cause us to suddenly stumble and lose our confidence and question our faith. John had to come to grips with the knowledge that Jesus was a different type of Messiah than what he probably was planning and dreaming of. John saw a dramatic upheaval. Remember, John saw change. John said Jesus would come and baptize with fire, whatever that fire means. But it seems a little bit more aggressive than the baptisms we see Jesus doing, right? But Jesus is talking about healing one person at a time. So Jesus says, go and tell John what you see and hear. Jesus is not defensive. He goes, go and tell John what you see and hear. The blind are receiving sight. The lame are walking again. People with leprosy are clean and told that they are clean. Welcome back to the community. The deaf hear. The dead are raised. The poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me. Jesus seems to be saying, this is where and how God is at work. Those who recognize it, those who are not offended because they're expecting something else, will know God's blessing. John was a true follower of Jesus, yet John was still learning about Jesus. John was still growing in his understanding of what the Messiah would be. And John will ultimately die for his faith in that prison, and he will die as a man of faith in Jesus. Jesus tells us, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist, yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Jesus seems to say John has a special place, and so do each one of us, each one of us who seeks to follow Jesus. We, like John, will follow, and we will not be perfect at it, and we will have our times of questions and doubts, and Jesus will be with us in those times of great faith and in those times of doubt. Whenever I had to finish my visit at the prison and began the long process of walking back out, there was nothing like going out the front door, out in that parking lot, and the sun hitting you in the face, and you couldn't help but smile when you see your car waiting there, and you got a key and a way to get home, and knowing that you're going home to see your family, you can't help but be thankful for the basic freedom of being able to go home and see your family. Jesus' work is ongoing in our day. Jesus calls all of us to be part of healing the sick, to be part of prison reform in our day, finding housing for all who are in need. And Jesus calls us to follow. And Jesus says, your place in the kingdom is ongoing, even in this day. Advent is about preparing for Jesus. So we can all ask, like John the Baptist did, are you the one who is to come? Or are we to wait for another? And if you believe, as I do, that Jesus is the Christ, Jesus is the Messiah, let us follow boldly. Let us follow in love. Let us be the healers our society so much needs. Let us be the liberators for those who are in all types of bondage. Let us be the reconcilers who bring people back together. And let us tell the good news of his coming in this day. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we thank you for the message of Jesus and the way he healed and the way he met people where they were and rose them from despair to a sense of joy that they were loved by God in that place and that time. Today, Lord, may joy live in us and live in your church and live the ministries we perform in your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing a favorite Advent hymn, O Come Emmanuel. And we have the praise team leading us.
Squandered and depleted, make gardens flourish in cities and neighborhoods. Cleanse polluted air and water so living things may breathe and drink and praise you. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Righteous God, we rejoice in your justice and racism and oppression. Deliver all who are great, unjustly imprisoned or persecuted. Reconcile nations and peoples in conflict. Bring an end to the war in Ukraine and relief for people displaced by war. Help us pray for our enemies. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Healing God, we rejoice in your compassion. Comfort any in distress because of worry, illness, or loss. Strengthen and protect health care workers, rescue teams, crisis counselors, and all who risk themselves to keep others safe. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Binding God, we rejoice in your company. Give us calm and patient hearts as we gather with family and friends. Keep us mindful of those with whom this season is not happy. Console the grieving and surround them with loving support. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pour out your spirit upon Ted and Brian, Gabby, Gail, Betty, E, Julie, Anatole, Steve, Michael, Joan, Charles, Patsy, and George B, Jesse, Anna, Arlene, and Caradad, Mark, Opal, Brandy, Bill, and Kurt, Samantha, Lauren, Jen, Ashley, Allie, and Kim, Judy, Gail, Willa, Jenny, Gabby J, and Ms. Martin. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And we ask for comfort and joy, guidance for Bill and Sue P, the Brock family, Patty C, family and friends of Mandy Magnet on her death, Penny Smith and family, Maggie P, Karen Terrivik on the passing of her mother, Allison Terrivik, the Arendt family, Natasha on the death of her cousin, family and friends of Jay Sasha on his death, and Kim J. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And Lord, we give praises for Kent and Tammy Anderson, for hosting the Christmas party, for Beth Comfort, for providing soup for Advent and midweek meals. Confirmands, Max Wright, Grace Stedman, Cash Campbell, Edgar Pettichon IV, Marie Park, James Schmidt, Rachel Lawrence, Kalia Wright, Reindeer Game Organizers, Leslie Robinson, Tim Floor and Josie Lopez, and all who attended the annual congregation meeting, God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Compassionate Lord and Savior, we offer now the additional prayers, prayers of our hearts and our minds.
Lord, I lift up to you praises and thanks for Maury's mother, Carol's short time in the hospital this week, that it was that she's on the mend now, and that it was a pleasant experience for her. It wasn't too hard, and she's feeling better. And from my prayer closet, I lift up to you with the congregation of my friend Max, that I couldn't tell you his last name, but you know, and I know him to be someone who loves you and loves his family, and I feel that he could use your blessing this week with some extra care, not knowing that for sure. And I lift up to you, God, any people that are working in package delivery this week, whether with the post office or some private company, as they face real busy times. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Invoke all things in your compassion, O God, and bring us into your light through the faithfulness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Share a sign of peace with those around you in a safe way. Be through it. Considering your estimate of giving for next year, 2023, you can just place that as an offering. You can go on the website and do it, or you can go to our church app called Realms and just log in as yourself and set it all up that way. So, can we ask God's blessings on the gifts and the giver?
Let us pray. Giver of every good thing, we set before you the gifts that you have already given to sustain our lives and to share with others. Help us to be good stewards of the earth and all that is in it, and let our lives be a testimony to the abundant peace you prepare for all who hunger. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should, at all times and in all places, give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will make all things new. Day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness, and so with all the choirs of angels, with a church on earth, and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. God, you are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. We give thanks, we give you thanks for his coming into the world, to fulfill for us your holy will, and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance." Again, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ is dying, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come now with joy to Emmanuel's table, feast at the banquet of hope and love. Please be seated as the ushers direct you forward. We invite you to receive the sacrament of Holy Communion, receive the bread in your outstretched hands. You may partake of the cup by individual glasses of grape juice or wine. All is ready.
Thank you.
house. Let us pray. God of abundance, we give you thanks that in this holy meal you have invited us to feast with you and one another. May the taste of your love remain with us, and may our words and our work in your name invite others into your local bountiful grace. Send us from your table to proclaim your presence, even as we await the glorious coming of Christ our Savior. Amen.
Spirit, the God of all grace, bless you now and forever. Amen. Our sending hymn will be Joy to the World. Please join in singing along with our praise.